Welcome to First Grapevine, a United Methodist Church. We're glad you have joined us for worship in person or online. Please take a moment and register your attendance by either filling out one of the registration cards or online through our church website, firstgrapevine.org, or our mobile app.
As we continue in the season of Lent, I want to encourage you to make plans now to participate in our Holy Week and Easter activities. Beginning Saturday, April 9th, during Breakfast with the Bunny, 8:30 to 10 a.m. in Founders Chapel. Bring your family for breakfast and photos with Easter Bunny, an outdoor prayer labyrinth, and resurrection eggs. On Palm Sunday, April 10th, come honor Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem with our children's choir and the waving of palm branches in all our worship services. Then Wednesday, April 13th through Friday, April 15th, join us at 12 noon in the sanctuary for our new concert series on organ and piano with guest artists Ken Surley, Scott Ayers, and our very own Linda Love. April 14th, we will have a Holy Thursday Seder service at 7 p.m. in the sanctuary, remembering Christ's Last Supper with His disciples. Good Friday, April 15th, there will be a tenebrae service at 7 p.m. in the sanctuary, focusing on the passion and crucifixion of our Lord Jesus. Then, come worship the risen Christ Easter Sunday morning during one of the following services of worship and praise. Our sunrise service at 7:30 and our contemporary worship at 11 will both be in the beautiful Grapevine Botanical Gardens just west of the church campus. Bring your own lawn chair for an outdoor celebration in the beauty of springtime. Triumphant traditional worship will convene at 8:30 and 11 a.m. in the sanctuary. And at 9:30 a.m., our new Family First service for parents and children will begin in Founders Chapel. Plan now for a fun, moving, and uplifting culmination of the Lenten season during Holy Week and Easter right here at First Grapevine.
Michael Hitt is our guest organist this week. Linda Love is taking some well-deserved time off. Also, Pastor Mike is away on a retreat, so it feels really special to get to be here 2 weeks in a row. Thank you. We'll keep the streak alive, or we'll try to. How about that? Well, if you are a guest, we would really appreciate it if you would fill out the registration card or sign in on the app so that we can connect with you and tell you more about our church. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. God of grace and peace, we thank you for this space and for this time where we can gather, we can hear your words spoken, and we can praise your name. Lord, fill us with your spirit. Move in us that we may know more about you and who you are calling us to be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I invite you to stand as you are able, and let us join our voices together with our opening hymn, To God Be the Glory.
Great things he has done.
may be seated. And while you do that, I'd like to invite the children to come forward for children's time.
Good morning. Is this on? Okay. You can hear me. That's great. And your first name? Let me see your tag right there. Blake. Okay. We have Blake and Alan. This is so great. Oh, it goes by Jazz. Oh, it's not. It's Jazz. Okay. Jazz and Harper. Got it. Okay. I'm Miss Carmen, and I love to do a new kind of language. And sometimes languages are not easy to, you know, like French or Spanish. Oh, you know Spanish? Do you know hola? Hola? It's not a person, it's a hello. Okay, well, we're going to do six signs today, and it's about the scripture, and Miss Carly is going to help us. And what we're going to do is we're going to learn this scripture. There's six key words I want us to learn, okay? Have you ever done anything like hello, you know, this is a sign, and this is okay? That's what I'm talking about. There you go. Got it. Okay. And this is a really cool scripture because I love it. I learned it when I was your age. And so Miss Carly's going to hold the mic, okay? And let me say this first. The six signs we're going to learn are, now you need to know this first. This means yes, and this means no. So if you don't want to do this, it's okay. It's okay. All right? So the six signs we're going to learn is God, loved, world, son, believes, and life. This is going to be so easy. This is so easy. Okay. Here we go. Okay.
For God to love... Oh, not yet. I'm doing it wrong. Okay. 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 So God,
this is God.
Oh, loved, oh, okay, I'm doing it wrong again. What do you want me to do? Okay.
I'll give you a
they
cue.
Can't hear you, though.
Oh, I good.
That's good. Okay. God, loved,
okay, God,
loved, loved.
World.
World.
Sun.
Sun. Believes.
Okay, and you're supposed to do something with this. Okay, there. Believes. Okay. Good job. And life.
You want me to say it? All right. I'm going to say the verse. You can say it, say along if you know it, but sign along with Carmen. For God, are you ready? Okay. Take a deep breath in. For God so loved the world. Oh, okay. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Yay. That was great.
My appreciation. You did a great job. Okay, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, you have such a sense of humor when you ask me to do this. And you... But you get me through it. And thank you to Carly and the children and the congregation. They are our family. Amen.
We always learn something new when Carmen does the children's time. So thank you for that. So in your bulletin, there is a little insert at the bottom. It's not an insert. It's a paragraph at the bottom. If you would like to help with some of the tornado relief. Is it tornado? Yeah. The tornado relief in Texas. There's a way for you to give. So now we're going to go to God in prayer. We're going to say a prayer together. We're going to sing the Lord's Prayer. And then we'll receive today's offering. So I'll invite you to take a deep breath, to let go of anything you're holding on to. Let's go to God in a posture of prayer. Holy God, we are grateful for your presence with us this morning. We're grateful that you meet us here. Wherever we are, if we're in celebration and joy, if we're in hurting and grief, God, you know each of those emotions. We ask that during this time, as we listen, as we sing, as we pray, that you would transform us, that you would help us to be the body of Christ that we're called to be. We pray for our world. We pray for those near and far who are in need of your love, who are in need of compassion and of grace. And we pray that we might be mindful of how you're leading us to be of help, how you're leading us to be the hands and feet of Christ. God, we pray for those things in our hearts that we know that we don't say aloud, because you know them, God. Be with each person here, each person watching online, with those things that they hold dear to them. And be with them and show them your way forward. In Christ's name we pray.
Our Father. In heaven, holy is your name.
Holy is your name.
Your kingdom come. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours forever. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours forever.
Will you stand for our doxology? I invite you to remain standing for our hymn of preparation this morning, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. now as Christians worshiping in a community of faith, let us affirm our faith before God and one another. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress, or persecution or famine, or nakedness or peril or sword? No, in all things we are more than conquerors through the one who loved us. We are sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Glory be to the Father.
Thank you. As we continue our Lenten series of encounters with Jesus, we find in chapter 3 a religious leader named Nicodemus coming to Jesus at night to speak with him. And Jesus tells him that in order to experience the kingdom of God, he must be born again. And Nicodemus starts to ask him, what does this mean? How can someone be born again? And Jesus talks about the spiritual rebirth that we all go through when we accept God, when we decide to follow Christ. And then we get to the 16th verse of the chapter, one of the most famous verses in the Bible. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, and whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Maybe you've heard that before, or you've heard of it before, but it summarizes God's goal and God's mission for us. And so it's our prayer that as we continue this journey towards Easter, that you would consider how you might be born again, and what God might be nudging in your life to be born again.
Couple of notes before I read the scripture. The guy portraying Nicodemus, that's actually Mark Eves, who puts these videos together for us on our team. And Julie Croft, where are you, Julie? That was excellent acting, by the way. Very contemplative. Yes, very, very good. I have another volunteer I'd like to highlight, to lift up for you, because it takes a countless number of you working behind the scenes just to make worship possible every week. And in our service here in the sanctuary, the slides are operated most of the time in here by a young man, Mr. Christian Mullins, who volunteers his time to run these slides. Yes. And you wouldn't know by watching him do it, but it's actually very difficult. And he volunteers his talents and his time in order to help lead us every week. And I lift that up for you if you would like to be a part of our media team. We would love to have you join us. If you maybe fancy yourself an actor, then you can see we've got parts to play every week. Or if you think, I don't want to be seen on camera, I never want to have to speak in a microphone, but I could come and help move some camera equipment, we could always use your help. We love having more people come and volunteer behind the scenes, and we get to spend time with you and get to know you better. That might sound like a threat. I don't know how you feel about us, but we'd like to know you, and we enjoy that time. So thank you for that pause. All right, Christian, will you pull up the scripture for us this morning? This is John 3, verses 1 through 16. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him. And Jesus replied, very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. How can someone be born when they are old? Nicodemus asked. Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born. And Jesus answered, very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. How can this be? Nicodemus asked. You are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and do you not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen, but still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. This is the word of God for the people of God, and we say thanks be to God. This is a very common passage of scripture. If you have ever darkened the door of a church, perhaps you have heard it before. When I read this in the 8:30 service, there were a couple of people who just started saying it along with me when we got to verse 16. They just couldn't help themselves. The words just came out. I know many of us in the room are the exact same way. And this has been talked about and preached probably more than any other passage in the entire New Testament. And I feel a certain way about that. And I'll use this example. I was reading the intro to a book about William Shakespeare and Shakespeare's writing. And this writer said about Shakespeare, if you want to know the height of human genius, of the ability to use language and to express emotion and what we live as human beings, then read William Shakespeare. And if you want to plumb the depths of human stupidity, then read a book like this about William Shakespeare. And I feel the same way sometimes about this passage. It speaks so powerfully for itself. Now, I offer that to you not from a sense of false humility. And believe me, I'm going to give my shot here in a moment, because when it comes to self-esteem, I have enough to be a donor. So spare me a few minutes as I do my best to add to the pile of words spoken about this passage. To set the scene, and I appreciate this video because it really highlighted the nature of this encounter that Jesus is having with Nicodemus. As you could see, even from our costumes, 2,000 years later, Nicodemus, as a Pharisee, who's a part of, the scripture calls it the council, but he's part of the Sanhedrin, and he would have dressed and would have been noticeably different from Jesus, who is a carpenter from a hick town. And Nicodemus is one of the Pharisees. Now, if you've been reading along with us, because we have that reading schedule, if you're just now hearing about that, I'll give you a copy after the service. You can jump in anytime. But if you've been reading along, you've gotten to a point now where you've seen that the Pharisees, these group of scholars, religious experts, are, in this story, the villains. And spoiler, I'll go ahead and ruin the end for you. They're successful in their endeavor to have Jesus silenced and killed. And it's easy, whenever we read this, a couple thousand years later, to see them as bad people, to see them as only the villains as they are in this story. But really, if you know a little bit about how they got here, then you can relate. You can understand. And while I definitely think they're very misguided and they got so lost in their original mission that they couldn't even recognize God's very own face, I admire their conviction. The Pharisees were people who did their absolute best to preserve the Jewish traditions and the way of life because evil empires were coming to wipe them off the face of the earth. They came so close to extinction, their families, their way of life, their faith, that they put everything into preserving this Jewish way of life. The rules, the interpretations, the way that you're supposed to follow it, how you live, how you dress, how you behave, everything so particular to such a degree so they could say to themselves, never again will this happen. The problem is they got so good at their rules and the things that they added to the Word of God, that they built a house of cards and they were terrified of someone like Jesus coming along and taking that away from them. And this is in chapter 3. Next week, we'd already gotten chapter 4, but if you've been reading along, even already now in chapter 3, Jesus is in Jerusalem. He has gone there. He's been teaching. He flipped over tables in the temple. He has really gotten their attention and made some people angry. But Nicodemus, one of the leaders of the Pharisees, again, a member of the Sanhedrin, a very important person, comes to Jesus at night. Now, why does he go at night? Some of the reasons are probably obvious. We assume he's going at night so he doesn't get recognized for associating with this annoying hippie who is threatening the Pharisees' way of life. But also, the writer of the Gospel of John uses light and dark to show someone's state of mind and the presence of their soul. Someone who's in darkness is still confused. They still don't know the light of Christ. And Nicodemus here is in darkness as he comes to Jesus. And a little bit more information, you see him say to Jesus, surely you can't be born again. Surely you can't go into your mother's womb again. He's not being dense when he says this. This is a highly intelligent man. No, this is a method of the Pharisees whenever they debate, whenever they argue, to have someone use a term that perhaps is vague or has different meaning. You point out the absurdity of the term to continue the conversation. He's following the playbook. He's doing exactly what he was taught in grad school. You know, you get educated beyond your intelligence sometimes, yes. At least I know I was. And Jesus is not being rude back to him when he says, surely you are a teacher of Israel and you know about such things. I think he's saying that in an ironic way, in a disarming way, in a way to say, let's continue this conversation just between you and between me. And it culminates with that verse that many of us, as I mentioned, so many of us know, verse 16, whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And I love to add verse 17 as well. I think that really helps drive home this point. For he didn't send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the whole world through him might be saved. And he's saying to Nicodemus, all these rules and regulations, this legalism that you have created, he's offering him freedom from that. He's saying, all these struggles, all this self-doubt, all this trying to prop yourself up on the way that you're doing religion, no, just believe in me. Believe in me. That's all you have to do. And let these other things follow. Now, again, this happened a couple thousand years ago. We saw an example of perhaps how they would have dressed. Even though there's such a gap and we don't necessarily follow rules like that, I do think we know what it means to do like the Pharisees and try to prop ourselves up on things that won't hold us, like our money, our career, relationships with certain people, trying to be a good person, just trying to do the right thing. And if you're trying to live that way and find hope and security in that, then you know you're not standing on solid ground. And like Nicodemus, we come in darkness looking for answers. Jesus says to him, whoever believes in me. Now, one thing I think is challenging about the word believe right there is to us, as we read that, belief is just a mental exercise. It's just something that happens between your ears. Let me give you an example. I believe in gravity. I really do. I can't see it, but I believe in it. I even believe that it operates at a rate of 9.8 meters per second squared. And you can wake me up in the middle of the night, and I can say that to you. And I believe that, but I don't think about it ever. In fact, I had to go and recheck that before I said that to you this morning, because it never crosses my mind. That kind of belief is just a mental exercise. I think to help us understand what Jesus is saying here, it's better to sub in the word value. I'll give you another example. I believe in my head that eating right, diet, exercise, taking care of myself. I believe that's good for me. I believe I'll live longer. I believe I'll have more energy. But if you were to follow me around and see how I took care of myself, you would come to the conclusion that I value pizza. In fact, just because I've said the word out loud, there's a high probability I'll order myself one later. I value pizza. But the thing is, whenever we think about value, and again, I know this analogy is about to break down, but follow with me just a little bit more. Valuing doesn't mean doing it better, doing it worse. The person who just tries to eat something green, some vegetables, for the first time in his life because he wants to see his kids grow up, and he's just trying to go for a walk every day, just trying, whether he's successful or not, he's trying to go for a walk, he's valuing diet and exercise just as well as, say, someone who is professionally fit, like an Arnold Schwarzenegger. Is Arnold better at valuing diet and exercise? Sure, but that doesn't matter. That doesn't change the quality of the value. If anything, the person who's just now starting out on that journey, if you were to measure, might value diet and exercise even more than Arnold. Value. And the same comes to this message that Jesus is saying to Nicodemus and to you and to me, is come, make this a part of your life. Just make that turn today. You don't have to be great at it. You don't have to go to seminary. You don't have to memorize the entire Bible. Start on this journey today and let God work on you. Make that choice to turn today and let the Holy Spirit move in your life. Come and value God's teachings, God's words, God's message of forgiveness for each and every one of us. And God's transformative power will do the rest. I think we have another issue with this scripture whenever we come to it. And that is that this is one that it doesn't always sit well with our Western mindset because it feels and it sounds exclusive. And I think sometimes we exclude ourselves out of things. We focus on the negative of, what have I done? Could God even love me? I get asked by people who have never come to church before whenever they meet me and they realize I'm a pastor and they get over the shock that a pastor will wear these shoes, even on a Sunday. Once they get over that, they say, and without any sense of humor in their voice, they'll say, I'm a little bit concerned I'll burst into flame right when I walk through the door. They really say that. I'm just concerned it's not a place for me there. They exclude themselves. But I don't think this verse is trying to do that at all. It's trying to offer something positive and a way forward. I was watching a TED talk by this guy named Simon Sinek. He was really popular several years ago for the book Start With Why. And he said of this mindset, the human brain can't comprehend the negative. I'll give you this example. It's a little test. Try it with me. Do not, whatever you do, do not think about an elephant. Aha. Every one of you sees an elephant, I know. And if you don't, you are lying. You can't think. Yeah. In church, no less. But the human brain can't comprehend the negative because you can focus on the positive. I'm a big fan of Formula One. I know that Netflix does a special on that. If you have no idea what that is, it's a racing series that puts little tiny European men in 800 horsepower go-karts, and they go at blinding speed on tracks. And there's a race today at noon, so I will be jetting out of here very quickly to catch that. I'm just kidding. I'm recording it. We can talk afterwards. But yesterday, as they were getting ready for the race, they're at this particular track, and a couple of the commentators we're watching the onboard camera as these little guys are weaving down this track at impossible speed, and the barriers, the walls, are just right there, just right there. And they say to each other, how do they do that? How do they not just have fear? Are they not gripped by fear by these walls as they're driving through? How do they not do that? They had a grizzled veteran with them in the booth who had won the championship years ago. He replied, just matter-of-factly, it's because they don't look at the walls. They don't think about the walls. They're thinking about the corner. They're focused on where they're going. And if they think about the walls, they'll crash into them for sure. But they don't do that. They think about the next corner and this lamp. And Jesus was saying to Nicodemus, all these rules and all these regulations, just focus on me. Look to me, and the rest will take care of itself. Jesus lived this out in a different part of the story where he was walking on water, and his disciples see him, and Peter wants to get out of the boat and go to him. And he gets out, and he's walking on water as he's looking at Jesus, but then he looks away, and he begins to sink. It's not until he looks at Jesus again that he is able to walk on the water. Nicodemus would have known a passage from the book of Proverbs, which is in the Old Testament, and I'm afraid it comes out of my mouth in King James as well. In all thy ways acknowledge God, and he will keep your paths straight. This is a message of hope and forgiveness. It's very positive for you and for me. It's a message that the world desperately needs to hear, is that all these things that you try to rely on, they're not going to work. Just turn to God. This story also says something about us and how God operates and how we're supposed to operate, which is his character Nicodemus. Please note in this chapter that he doesn't immediately say, take me to the nearest body of water, I need to be baptized right now. It doesn't say he became a disciple and went and planted churches all over the world. It says none of that. Because he's continuing to wrestle with this. He's continuing to be there. God keeps working on him. But it doesn't happen immediately. He's mentioned a couple other times in the New Testament. He's there when they go to bury Jesus. He doesn't go away. But it doesn't happen immediately. I think it's important to point that out because God didn't give up on Nicodemus. God doesn't give up on us. And we shouldn't give up on our neighbors. We shouldn't give up on the people in our lives that we're praying for that we know are struggling right now. We shouldn't give up on the people that are around us who are living lives that they know, you know they're hurting themselves and you care for them and you pray for them. Don't give up because God doesn't give up on him. God keeps pursuing him. So last week we made an announcement. If you weren't here, I apologize that we had to jet out of this room to run down to the next room to make this announcement. I ran down there, my cape flailing behind me like I was Batman or something. But we made the announcement that starting in July, I'll be appointed here as senior pastor. And I'm very excited about that. Oh, thank you for the golf clap, one person in the room. That was great. I'm just playing. I was just playing. I wasn't looking for applause. I was just glad nobody stood up and threw something. That's all. That's the basic standard that I'm working for here. But I'm just so grateful to get to be a part of what God continues to do here, and I look forward to where God is leading us. There are just a couple of things that are really important to me and are already on my mind. Number one is I want to continue my crusade for casual footwear in a church. Yeah, so glad to see, yes, thank you. So glad to see so many of you adopting the tennis shoe lifestyle. But the other is to do like Jesus does here for Nicodemus and to continue to create space for people who are walking in darkness, who are struggling with something, to come and to hear a message of hope and of good news. Because you got to see, Jesus has a lot going on, but he makes time to have this conversation with Nicodemus. And we're trying to do more of the same right here. In a second, we're going to have more information about the organ concert series during Holy Week. We really hope that you can put that on your calendars. It's only going to be about 30 minutes at noon, so that if you have a day job, you can come and enjoy it. And so you can invite people you know. And it's an easy invitation. It's an easy hook, a line to throw out there, which is just, hey, do you like music? We have a very expensive and cool pipe organ. Just come during lunch and hear some music. We're starting a new service at 9:30. We've got a video about that that explains a little bit more, but we're just trying to lower the threshold of difficulty of coming through the doors to church for people who have kids, who are struggling every day, who are facing a crazy world and trying to know how to just be good parents to their kids. We're just trying to create more space to have these conversations, to say, God loves you. God loves you so much that he sent his only begotten son. God loves you so much that he sent us here as First Grapevine to welcome you with open arms into the family of God. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, I thank you so much for the way that you came and you encountered Nicodemus, and you are still encountering each and every one of us today. Lord, show us how we can not only receive this message of hope, but we can share it with a world in need. In Jesus' name, amen.
The music ministry of First Grapevine is presenting its first ever noontime organ concert series, taking place Wednesday, April 13th, Holy Thursday, April 14th, and Good Friday, April 15th. Each day at noon, a talented DFW organist will offer a 30 to 40 minute music presentation appropriate for Holy Week. On Wednesday, organist Ken Surley will present a selection of reflective organ pieces appropriate for the Lenten season. Ken is organist at Plymouth Park United Methodist Church, where he has served for over 30 years. He is certified by the American Guild of Organists and has played literally all over the world, accompanying various choirs and ensembles. On Thursday, well-known organist and pianist Scott Ayers will provide a wonderful program of organ and piano selections. Scott is a former organist of Highland Park United Methodist Church and currently hosts a popular weekly Facebook Live broadcast where he plays arrangements of hymn requests which he takes online. Part of Scott's program will be taking requests, so come with your favorite hymn in mind and perhaps you'll hear a masterful piano rendition. On Friday, our own organist and master musician Linda Love will be offering a program of hymns and prayers appropriate to the sacredness of Good Friday. Linda has had a long career as an organist, accompanist, and vocal coach, and currently serves as pianist and organist for First Grapevine, as well as the director of the Fishers of Men Men's Ensemble. You will not want to miss any of our amazing presenters. Mark your calendars to attend this new annual event.
We hope you'll make some time in your week to pause, to relax, to breathe in, and to enjoy this way of being in prayer through music and worship through music. We've come now to the time of our service where we get ready to go forth. And so your invitation for today is to consider how you might live differently because you worshiped here today. Not because of anything that we've done, but because of what God is doing in you. Maybe that's taking one of the journals and reading through the book of John with us. Maybe it's taking one of the God is Big Enough bracelets to a friend. We invite you to take those questions, to take your doubts and all your questions like Nicodemus had, and to explore them, to live them, to pray about them. If you are looking for a church home or if you're looking to become a Christian, there'll be someone in the back at the end of the service in that corner outside that says new here, and you're welcome to talk to them about that. But for now, will you stand as we sing our last hymn?
Christ proclaims.
I see the time. I have one more video to show you, but I understand as Methodists, we are united in our commitment to lunch. And so if you have places to go, I formally dismiss you. If you'd like to stick around to hear something about our new service, it won't take too long. Whatever you decide, I hope you have a great day and a great week. Go in peace.
Hi, I'm Dan. This is my family, the Davises. This is Kristen, Katie, and Drew. And we're really excited about the new Family First Service. So the whole idea of the Family First Service is to bring families and have them spend time together. A lot of times when you come to church, you find that as soon as you get here, you're off to different Sunday school classes, often learning different material. So here's an opportunity for you to spend time and grow as a family together, worshiping together in one place. We expect a certain level of chaos with this service, knowing that we're going to have families and people of all ages. We have planned activities that are going to drive a lot of fun into the service. So we're really excited to get started. We hope to see you on Easter.